Judith Anderson. Starring in Medea. By Robinson Jeffers. Staged by Jose Quintero. Produced by David Susskind. This is the story of Medea, who renounced her own people in order to marry the Greek hero, Jason. So great was her love that she killed her own brother while fleeing with Jason. And now, years later, she lives in Corinth with her two young sons. Jason has deserted her. She is alone in a strange country. Her only companion in grief, her nurse.
I wish the longship Argo had never passed that perilous channel between the simple Egades. I wish the pines that made her mast and her oars still waved in the wind on Mount Pelion, and the gray fish hawk still nested in them. The great adventurers had never voyaged into the Asian sunrise, to the shores of morning, for the golden fleece. For then my mistress Medea would never have seen Jason, nor loved and saved him, nor cut herself off from home to come with him into this country of the smiling, chattering Greeks and the roofs of Corinth, over which I see evil hang like a cloud. For she is not meek, but fierce, and the daughter of a king. If at first all went well, the folk of Corinth were kind to her. They were proud of her beauty, and Jason loved her. Happy is the house where the man and the woman love and are faithful. Now all is changed. All is black hatred. For Jason has turned from her. He calls the old bond a barbarian mating, not a Greek marriage. He has cast her off and wedded the yellow-haired child of Creon, the ruler here. He wants worldly advantage, fine friends, and a high place in Corinth. For these, he's willing to cast Medea like a harlot and betray the children that she's born here. He is not wise, I think. But Medea lies in the house, broken with pain and rage. She will neither eat nor drink except her own tears. She turns her face towards the earth, remembering her father's house and her native land that she abandoned for the love of this man who now despises her. And if I try to speak words to her, she only stares at me. Great eyes like stones, just like a stone on the shore or a wave of the sea. And I think she hates even her children. She is learning what it is to be a foreigner, cast out, alone and despised. She will never learn to be humble. She will never learn to drink evil like harmless water. Oh, I'm terrified of her. Whether she'll thread a knife through her own heart, or whether she'll hunt the bridegroom and his new bride. Oh, what more dreadful evil stalks in the forest of her dark mind? I know that Jason would have been wiser to tempt a lioness, or naked-handed steal the whelps of a tiger. Here come the happy children. Little they know of their mother's grief.
Who's servant to my lady? Why do you sit out here keeping watch in solitude with those grim eyes? Is it some trouble of your own that you're lamenting? I should think Medea would need your care.
It is all one to me, dear, whether I am there or here. Yes, it is mine, my trouble. My lady's grief is my grief. It has hurt me so I had to come out and speak it to the earth and the sky.
Is she still in that deep despair?
You are lucky, old watchdog of Jason's boys. I envy you. You do not see her. This evil is not declining. It is just at dawn. I dread the lion-eyed glare of its noon.
Is she so wrought?
Yet neither you nor Medea knows the latest and worst.
What?
Shouldn't you spoken? No, it is nothing.
No, now tell me the truth, old man. You and I are two slaves. We can trust each other. We can keep secrets, hmm?
I heard them saying when we walked beside the holy fountain, Pyrene, where the old men sit in the sun on the stone benches, they were saying that Creon, the lord of this land, intends to drive out Medea and the children with her. These innocent boys out of this house and out of Corinth. And they must wander through the wild world, homeless and helpless.
I don't believe it. Oh, no. Jason may hate the mother, but he'd never let his own sons be cast out.
He has made a new alliance. He is not a friend of this house.
Oh, if this were true.
Yeah!
Listen, I hear a voice.
Yeah!
Take the children away. Keep them away from us.
That is my wish.
Take them to the other door, quickly.
Myself, my enemies, my children. Destruction, that's the word. Grind, crush, burn, destruction.
Oh, this is my terror, to hear her always hearken back to the children, like a fierce hound at fault. Oh, unhappy one, they're not to blame.
If any God heals me, let me die. Ah, rotten. Death is the only water to wash.
So it's a bad thing to be born of high race and brought up willful and powerful in a great house, unruled and ruling many. Then if misfortune comes, it is unendurable. It drives you mad. I say that poor people are happier, the little commoners, the humble people, the poor in spirit. They can lie low under the wind and live, while the tall oaks and the cloud-raking mountain pines go mad in the storm, writhe, groan, and crash. This is the wild and terrible justice of God. It brings on great persons the great disasters. What do you want?
I hear her crying again. It is dreadful.
Her lamentation. She is beautiful and deep in grief. We couldn't help coming. We are friends of this house, and its trouble hurts us.
You are right. Friends, it is not a home, it is broken. A house of grief and of weeping.
Hear me, God, let me die. What I need, all dead under the great cold stone. For a year, and 1,000 years, and another 1,000, cold as the stone cold. You're noble again, proud, straight, and silent. Crimson cloaked in the blood of our wounds.
Shining sky, divine earth, hearken not to the song that this woman sings. It is not her mind's music, her mind is not here. She does not know what she prays for. Pain and wrath are the singers.
Unhappy one, never pray for death. Never pray for death. He is here all too soon. He strikes from the clear sky like a hawk. Hides behind green leaves, or he waits around the corner of a wall. Oh, never pray for death. Never pray for death. For that prayer will be answered.
I know poison. I know the bright seas of steel. I know fire. But I will not be mocked by my enemies, and I will not endure pity. Pity and contempt our sister and brother, twin born. I will not die tamely. I will not allow blubber eyed pity nor contempt either to snivel over the stones of my tomb. I am not a Greek woman.
No, a barbarian woman from savage Colchis at the bitter end of the Black Sea. Does she boast of that?
She doesn't know what she is saying.
Poison, death magic, the sharp sword, the hemp rope. Death magic, death!
I hate Jason that made this sorrow. Old and honored servant of a great house, do you think it wise to leave your lady alone in there, except perhaps a few slaves, building that terrible acropolis of deadly thoughts? We Greeks believe that solitude is very dangerous. Great passions grow into monsters in the dark of the mind. But if you share them with loving friends, they remain human, they can be endured. I think you ought to persuade Medea to come from that dark dwelling and speak with us before her heart breaks or she does harm to herself. She has lived among us. We've learned to love her. We'd gladly tell her so. It might comfort her spirit.
Do you think so? She wouldn't listen. Oh,
She's coming. Speak carefully to her. Make your words a soft music.
Oh, my dear, my poor child.
They say she is dangerous. Look at her eyes. She is a witch, but not evil. She can make old men young again. She did it for Jason's father.
All the people of her country are witches. They know about drugs and magic. They are savages. But they have a wild wisdom.
Poor soul. It hasn't helped this one much.
I will look at the light of the sun this last time. I wish from that blue sky the white wolf of lightning would leap and burst my skull and my brain. And like a burning babe, cling to these breasts. Ah! Ah! Someone is here. I did not know I had visitors. Women of Corinth, if anything has been spoken too loudly here, consider that I believed I was alone, and I have some provocation. You've come, let me suppose, with love and sympathy to peer at my sorrow. I understand well enough that nothing is ever private in a Greek city. Whoever withholds anything is thought sullen or proud, undemocratic, I think you call it. This is not always just. But we know that justice, at least on earth, is a name, not a fact. And as for me, I wish to avoid any appearance of being proud. Of what? Of affliction? I will show you my naked heart. You know that my lord Jason has left me and made a second marriage with a bright-haired child of wealth and power. I too was a child of power, but not in this country. And I spent my power for love of Jason. I poured it out before him like water. I made him drink it like wine. I gave him success and fame. I saved him his precious life, not once, many times. You may have heard what I did for him. I betrayed my father for him. I killed my brother to save him. I made my own land to hate me forever. And I fled west with Jason in the Greek ship under the thunder of the sail, weeping and laughing. That huge journey through the Black Sea and the Bosphorus, where the rocks clang together, through the Sea of Marmara and through the Hellespont, watched by the spearmen of wealthy Troy, and home. Greek water. His home. My exile. My endless exile. Here I have loved him and borne him sons. And this man has left me and taken Creon's daughter to enjoy her fortune and put aside her soft yellow hair and kiss her young mouth.
She's terrible. Stone with stone eyes. Look, the foam flake on her lip that flickers with her breathing.
She is pitiable. She is under great injury.
I do not know what other women. I do not know how much a Greek woman will endure.
The women of my race are somewhat rash and intemperate. As for me, I want simply to die.
For Jason is not to smile at his bride over my grave. Nor that great man Creon hang wreaths and make a feast day in Corinth. Oh, let the wreaths be bright blinding fire, and the songs a high wailing, and the wine blood.
Daughter of sorrow, beware. It is dangerous to dream of wine. It is worse to speak of wailing or blood. For the images that the mind makes finds a way out. They work into life.
Let them work into life.
There are some evils that cannot be cured by evil. But patience remains, and the gods watch all.
Let them watch my enemies go down in blood.
Is he everywhere? Some great person is coming. It is Creon himself.
Creon is coming.
He is dark with anger. Oh, my lady, my child, bend in this wind and not be broken.
You have admirers, I see. Abate your pride. These people will not be with you where you are going. Medea, woman of the stone forehead and hate-filled eyes, I've made my decision. I've decided that you must leave this land at once and go into banishment. You, with your children. I intend to remove a root of disturbance out of the soil of Corinth. I'm here to see to it. I will not return home until it is done.
You mean banishment?
Exile. Banishment. Go where you may, Medea, but here you abide no more.
But I with my children.
I will not take them away from you.
The children, my lord.
What are you muttering?
Nothing. I'm praying to my gods for wisdom. You for mercy. My sons are still very young, tender and helpless. You know, my lord, what exile means, to wander with fear and famine for guide and driver through all the wild winter storms and the rage of the sun, and beg a bread crust and be derided. Pelted with stones in the villages, held a little low in the scavenger dogs, kicked, scorned, and slaved. Children, my lord, are Jason's children. Your chosen friend, I believe. And now even closer bound. And as for me, your servant. Oh, Master of Corinth, what have I done? Why must I be cast?
I will tell you frankly. Because you nourish rancorous ill will toward persons whom I intend to protect. I send you out before you've time to do harm here. And you are notorious for occult knowledge. Sorcery, poisons, magic. Men say you can even sing the moon down from heaven and make the holy stars to turn backward against the purpose and current of nature. As to that, I know not. I know you are dangerous. You threaten my daughter. You have to go.
But I wish her well, my lord. I wish her all happiness. I hope that Jason may be as kind to her
as to me.
That is your wish.
I misspoke. I thought of old days.
I acknowledge, Medea, that you have some cause for grief. I all the more must guard against your dark wisdom and bitter heart.
You misjudge me cruelly. It is true, I have some knowledge of drugs and medicines. I can sometimes cure sickness. Is that a crime? These dark rumors, my lord, are only the noise of popular gratitude. You must have observed it often. If any person knows a little more than the common man, the people suspect him. If he brings a new talent, how promptly the hateful whispers begin. But you are not a common man, Lord of Corinth. You will not fear knowledge.
No, nor change my decision. I'm here to see you leave this house and the city, and not much time. Move quickly, gather your things, and go. I pity you, Medea, but you must go.
You pity me? You pity me? I will endure a dog's pity or a wart-grown toad's. May God who hears me, we shall see in the end who's to be pitied. No!
This is good. This is what I desire. Unmask the livid face of your hatreds and I see whom I deal with. Serpent and wolf.
Ah!
A wolf from Asia. I'd rather have you rage now than do harm later. Now, Medea, out of here before my men drive you out.
You see a woman driven half mad with sorrow, laboring to save her little children. No wolf, my lord. And though I was born in far of Asia, call that misfortune, not vice. The races of Asia are human, too, as the bright Greeks are, and our hearts are as brittle. You hurt us, we cry. We have children and love them as Greeks do. You have a daughter, sir?
Yes, and I'll keep her free of your female hatred.
Oh, it is not true. I'm not jealous. I never hated her.
What, jealous for the sake of Jason? Kai, I'm far past wanting Jason, my lord. You took him and gave him to her, and I will say that you did well, perhaps wisely.
Your daughter's loved by all. She's beautiful. If I were near her, I would soon love her.
You can speak sweetly enough. You can make honey in your mouth like a brown bee when it serves your turn.
Oh, not honey, the truth.
Trust you or not, you are going to leave this country, Medea. What I decide is fixed. It is like the firm rocks of Acrocorinth, which neither earthquake can move nor a flood of tears melt. Make ready quickly. I have a guest in my house. I should return to him.
What guest? Oh, my lady, ask him. Who's the guest? If powerful and friendly, he might be a refuge for us in bitter exile.
I know that your will is granite. But even on the harsh face of a granite mountain, some flowers of mercy may grow in season. Have mercy on my little sons, Creon, though there is none for me.
How long, woman? This is decided, done, finished.
I am not a beggar. I will not trouble you. I shall not live long.
Sire, grant me a few hours yet. One day to prepare in one little day before I go out of Corinth forever.
What? No. I told you, the day is today. Medea, this day, and the hour is now.
There are no flowers on this mountain. Not one violet. Not one anemone.
Your face, my lord, is like flint!
If I could find the right words, if some god would lend me a touch of eloquence, I'd show you my heart. I'd lift it out of my breast and turn it over in my hands. You'd see how pure it is of any harm or malice toward you or your household. Look at it. Not a speck. Look, my lord. They call mercy the jewel of kings. I am praying to you as to one of the gods.
Destroy us, not utterly. To go out with no refuge, nothing prepared, is plain death. I would rather kill myself quickly in here.
If I had time but to ask the slaves and strolling beggars where to go, how to live. And I must gather some means. One or two jewels and small gold things. I have to trade them for bread and goat's milk. Oh, wretched, wretched, wretched I am, I and my boys. I beseech you, Creon. By the soft yellow hair, the cool, smooth forehead, and the white knees of that young girl who's now Jason's bride. Lend me this inch of time. One day, half a day, for this one is now half gone, and I will go my sad course and vanish in the morning,
quietly as dew that drops on the stones at dawn and is dry at sunrise. You will never again be troubled by any word or act of mine. And this I pray you for your dear child's sake. Oh, Creon, what is half a day in all the rich years of common?
I will think of it. I'm no tyrant. I've been merciful to my own hurt many times. Even to myself, I seem to be foolish if I grant you this thing. No, Medea, I will not grant it. Well, we will watch you as a hawk does a viper. What harm could she do in the tale of one day? Ah, a ruler ought to be ruthless, but I am not. I'm a fool in my own eyes, whatever the world may think. I can be gruff with warriors. A woman weeping floods me off course. Take it then. Make your preparations. But if tomorrow's sun shines on you here, Medea, you die. Enough words, thank me not. I want my hands washed of this business.
I will thank you. And the whole world will hear of it.
I have seen this man's arrogance. I watched and heard him. I am of Corinth, and I say that Corinth is not well ruled.
The city where even a woman, even a foreigner, suffers unjustly the rods of power is not well ruled.
Oh, unhappy Medea, what haven, what sanctuary, where will you wander? Which of the gods, Medea, drives you through waves of woe? The mooring broken, the anchor head from harbor hopeless.
This barking dog, this dull fool.
Gods of my father's country, you saw me low on my knees before the great dog of Corinth. Humble, holding my heart in my hands for a dog to bite. Break this dog's teeth! Women, it is a bitter thing to be a woman. A woman is weak for warfare. She must use cunning. Men boast their battles, I tell you this, and we know it. It is easier to stand in battle three times, in the front line, in the stabbing fury, than to bear one child. And a woman, they say, can do no good but in childbirth. Maybe so. They can do evil. She can do evil! I wept before that tall dog. I wept my tears before him. I degraded my knees to him. I gulled and flattered him. Oh, triple fool! He has given me all that I needed, a little time. A space of time. Death is dearer to me than what I am now. And if today by sunset the world has not turned and turned sharp too, let your dog, Creon, send two or three slaves to kill me in a court, to strangle me. I will stretch out my throat to it. But I have a bitter hope, women. I begin to see light through the dark wood. Between the monstrous trunks of the trees at the end of the tangled forest, an eye hole, a pinpoint of light. I shall not die, perhaps, as a pigeon dies, nor like an innocent lamb that feels a hand on its head and looks up from the knife of the man's face and dies. No! Like some yellow-eyed beast that has killed its hunters, let me lie down on the hound's bodies and the broken spears. There.
to use. There are so many doors through which painful death may glide in and catch. Which one? Which one? Which one? What guest is in Creon's house?
What? Oh, an Athenian ship came from the north last night. It is Aegeus, the lord of Athens.
Aegeus, my lady, knows him. I believe he will help us. Some god has sent him here. Some savior god.
He is leaving, I think, today.
My lady. Lord Aegeus is here in Corinth. Creon's guest, Aegeus of Athens. If you will see him and speak him fairly, we have a refuge.
I have things in my hand to do. Be quiet.
Listen to me. You are driven out of Corinth. You must find shelter. Aegeus of Athens is here.
What's that to me?
I lifted you in my arms when you were this long. I gave you milk from these breasts that are now dead leaves. I saw the little beautiful body straighten and grow tall, oh child. Almost my child. How can I not try to save you? Life is better than death.
Not now.
Time's running out.
I have time. Oh, I have time. It would be good to stand here 1,000 years and think of nothing but the deaths of free persons.
Oh, there's no hope then. Ah, child, if you could do this red thing you dream of, all Corinth would pour against you.
After my enemies are punished and I've heard the last broken moan, Corinth, what's that? I'll sleep. I'll sleep well. I'm alone against all. I'm so weary that it is pitiful.
Look, who's coming? I see the sunlight glitter on lances.
It is Jason.
Jason?
Medea's worst enemy, who should have been her dearest protector.
What business have you here, you women clustered like buzzing bees at the hive door? Where is Medea?
There, mourning for what you have done.
What she has done, not I. Not by my will, she and my sons are exiled.
Is there another dog here?
So, Medea, you have once more affronted and insulted the head of Corinth. This is not the first time I've seen what a fool anger is. You might have lived here happily, secure and honored. I hoped you would, by being just a little decently respectful toward those in power. Instead, you had to go mad with anger and talk yourself into exile. To me, it matters little what you say about me. But rulers are sensitive. Time and again, I've smoothed down Creon's indignation. Then you, like a mad woman, like a possessed imbecile, wag your head and let the words flow again. You never cease from speaking evil against him and his family. So now, call yourself lucky, Medea, not to get worse than exile. In spite of all this, I have your interest at heart and am here to help you. Exile's a bitter business. I want to make some provision for you. I wish you no harm, although you hate me. And in particular, the children. My sons, our sons. You might have been decent enough to have thought of our sons.
Did you consider them when you betrayed this house?
Certainly I considered them. It was my hope that they would grow up here, and I, having married power, could protect and favor them. And if perhaps, after many years, I become dynast of Corinth, for that is Creon's desire to make me his heir, our sons would have been a king's sons. I hope to help them wherever they go. Now, of course, must look forward to younger children.
Ah, it's enough! Something might happen. It is likely that something might happen to the bride and the marriage.
I'll guard against it. Evidently, Creon is right to be rid of you.
Have you finished now? I thought I would let you speak on and spread out your shamelessness before these women, the way a Tyrian trader unrolls his rare fabrics. Do you like it, ladies? It is the dog's daughter's husband. It is a brave person. It has finally got up the courage for the guard of spears to come and look me in the face. Oh, Jason, how have you pulled me down to this hell of vile thoughts? I did not use to talk like a common woman. I loved you once. And I'm ashamed of it. But there are some things that ought to be remembered by you and me. That blue day when we drove through the Hellespont into Greek sea, and the great-shouldered heroes were singing at the oars, and those birds flying through the blown foam, that day was too fine, I suppose, for Creon's daughter's man to remember. But you might remember whether I cheated my father for you and tamed the fire-breathing, brazen-hoofed bulls, and whether I saved your life in the field of the teeth. And you might remember whether I poisoned the great serpent and got you the golden fleece, and fled with you, and killed my brother when he pursued us, making myself abominable in my own home. And then in yours, I got your enemy Peleus hacked to death by his own daughter's hands. Whatever these fine Corinthian friends of yours may say against my rapid and tricky wisdom, you it has served. You it has served well. Here are five times, if I've counted right and all's not counted. Your adventure would have been dusty death if I'd not saved you. But now you think your adventures are over. You are safe and high-placed in Corinth and will need me no more. It is a bit of a dog, isn't it, women? It is well qualified to sleep with a dog's daughter. But for me, Jason, me, driven by the hairy snouts from the quadruped marriage bed, what refuge does your prudent kindness advise? Shall I fly home to Colchis to put my neck in the coil of a knotted rope for the crimes I've served you with? Or shall I go and kneel to the daughters of Peleus? They would indeed be happy to lay their hands on my head, holding the very knives and the cleavers that carved their sire. The world is a little closed to me, huh? By the things I have done for you.
I'll go to the palace and seek for Aegis. There is no other hope.
I see, Medea. You've been a very careful merchant of benefits. You forget none. You keep a strict reckoning. But some little things that I, on my side, have done for you ought to be in the books, too. As, for example, that I carried you out of the dirt and superstition of Asiatic Colchis into the rational sunlight of Greece and the marble music of the Greek temples. Is that no benefit? And I have brought you to meet the first minds of our time and to speak as an equal with the great heroes and the rulers of cities. Is that no benefit? And now this grievous thing that you hate me for, that I've married Creon's young daughter, little Creusa. You think I did it like a boy or a woman out of blind passion? I did it to achieve power here, and I'd have used that power to protect you and our sons. But your jealous madness has muddled everything. And finally, as to those acts of service you so loudly boast, whom do I thank for them? I thank divine Venus, the goddess who makes girls fall in love. You did them because you had to do them. Venus compelled you. I enjoyed her favor. A man dares things, you know. He makes his adventure in the cold eye of death. And if the gods care for him, they appoint an instrument to save him. If not, he dies. You were that instrument.
Here it is. The lowest, the obscene dregs. The slime, the loathing. The muddy bottom of a mouth. When a scoundrel begins to invoke the gods. You had better go, Jason. Vulgarity is a contagious disease. And in a moment, what could I do but spit at you like a peasant or curse you like a drunken slave? You'd better take yourself back to little Creusa.
I came to help and save you, if possible.
Your help is not wanted. Go, go.
I came to see my boy.
Now, quickly.
Yours the regret, then.
Surely know it. Loathing is all.
His flesh, he is touched and foul. These hands that wrought for him, these knees that ran his errands, this body that took his, what they call love and made children of it. If I could tear off the flesh, the children, the memory. Poor misused hands. Poor defiled arm, your bones are not unshapely. If I could tear off the flesh, it'd be bones, naked bones. Salt scoured bones. On the shore, at home, in Colchis.
God save me from the fire and the hunger of the sword. Keep me from the hateful sea and the jagged lightning and the violence of love.
A little love is a joy in the house. A little fire is a jewel against frost and darkness.
A great love is a fire that burns the beams of the roof. The doorposts are flaming and the house falls. A great love is a lion in the cattle pen. The herd goes mad. The heifers run bawling and the claws are in their flanks. Too much love is an armed robber in the treasury. He has killed the gods, and he walks in blood.
Now I see the black end. The end of great love. And God keep me from it. The unburied horror, the unbridled hatred, the vultures tearing a corpse. God keep me clean of those evil beaks.
What is she doing, that woman? Staring like stone, staring. She's moved not.
Annihilation. The word is pure music. Annihilation. To annihilate the past is not possible, but its fruit in the present can be nipped off. Am I to look in my son's eyes and see Jason's forever? How could I endure the endless defilement, those lives that mix Jason and me? Better to be clean bones on the shore, bones have no eyes at all. How could they weep? White bones on the black seashore. Oh, but that's far, not yet. Corinth must howl first.
Holy fountains flow up from the earth. The eagle and the wild swan fly up from the earth, and righteousness also has flown up from the earth to the feet of God. It is not here, it is up there. Peace and pity are departed. Hatred is here. Hatred is heavy, it clings to the earth. Love blows away, hatred remains.
Women hate war, but men will wage it again. Women may hate their husbands and sons, their fathers, but women will never hate their own children.
But as for me, I will do good to my husband. I will love my sons and daughters and adore the gods.
If I should go into the house with a sharp knife to the man and his bride. Or if I could fire the room they sleep in and hear them wake in the white of the fire and cry to each other and howl like dogs and howl and die. But I might fail. I might be cut down first. The knife might turn in my hand and the fire not burn, and my enemies could laugh at me. No, I have subtler means and more deadly cruel. I have my dark art that fools call witchcraft. Not for nothing I have worshipped the wild gray goddess that walks in the dark, the wise one, the terrible one, the sweet huntress, flower of night, Hecate. In my house, at my heart.
My lady, he was leaving Creon's door. He's coming. Egypt is coming. The power of Athens.
Ancient goddess, whom I and my people make the sacrifice of black lambs and black female hounds. Holy One, haunter of crossroads, queen of night, Hecate, help me now to remember in my mind the use of the venomous fire, the magic song, and the sharp gem.
He is here, my lady. Athens is here.
Medea, rejoice. There is no fairer greeting from friend to friend. Hail and rejoice, Medea.
Rejoice. It may be so. It may be I shall rejoice before the sun sets.
But what has happened? Your eyes are cavernous and your mouth twitches.
And well enough fools trouble me. Where are you traveling from, Aegis?
From Delphi, when I went to consult the ancient oracle of Apollo.
Oh, Delphi. Did you get a good answer?
An obscure one. Some god or other has made me unable to beget a child. That is my sorrow. But the oracle never gives plain responses. I tell you these things because you are skilled in mysteries and might help me to the god's meaning.
You want a child. What did Apollo say to you?
That I must not unloose the hanging foot of the wineskin. until I return to the hearth of my fathers.
You've never had a child?
No. And it is bitterness.
Oh, but when misfortune comes, it is bitter to have children and watch their star-like faces grow dim to endure it.
When death comes, Medea, it is for a childless man utter despair. Darkness, extinction. One's children are the life after death.
Do you feel it so? Do you feel it so? Then if you had a dog-eyed enemy and needed absolute vengeance, you'd kill the man's children first, and child him, and then unlife him.
I do not care to think of such horrors. I have no enemy. But what is it? What is the matter, my dear? Your trembling, wild fever flames in your eyes?
I'm well enough. Fools trouble me in dogs, but not that.
What has happened, my dear?
My dear, my love.
I would not hurt my children. Their father hurts them.
What do you mean, Jason? What has Jason done?
He has betrayed and denied both me and them.
Jason has done that? Why? Why?
He has cast me out and married Creon's young daughter. And Creon this very day is driving us into black exile.
And Jason consents to that?
He's glad of it.
Ask him for refuge. Ask him to receive you in Athens.
Do you not think such men ought to be punished, Aegis?
I think it is villainous. They told me nothing of this. You mean you are driven into exile?
Into homeless exile.
But why?
Because our presence here is embarrassing to the young bride. Do you not think such men ought to be punished, Aegis?
But where will you go?
If there's any rightness on earth or in heaven, they will be punished.
But where will you go to, my dear?
What? To death, of course.
Oh, she is all bewildered, sir, in the deep storm and ocean of grief. Or she would ask of you refuge in Athens.
Oh, so I should. That startled the man. Aegis, will you shelter me in Athens?
Why, yes. Yes. I will not take you now from Corinth. It would not be right. I want no quarrel with Creon. I am his guest here. But if you by your own means should come to Athens, I will take care of it.
I could repay you for it. I know the remedies that would make a dry stick flame into flower and fruit.
You'd cure my sterility?
I could do so.
You are famous for profound knowledge of drugs and charms. You'll come to Athens?
If I choose. If the gods decided so. But Aegis, would you protect me if I came? I have certain enemies. If powerful enemies came baying for my blood, would you protect me?
Why, yes. What enemies? Yes, Athens protects.
I should need peace and a free mind while I prepared the medicines to make you well.
Oh, you'll have them. You'll have them, my dear. You know, you've seen the huge stones in the old war belt of Athens. Come the four ends of the world, they could not break it. You'll be safe there. I am your pledge.
Will you swear it, Aegis?
Well, why? I have promised.
I trust you. The oath is formal. Your cure depends on it. You swear by the fruitful earth and high shining heaven to protect me in Athens against all men. Swear it.
I swear by the fruitful earth and the high shining heaven to protect you in Athens against all men.
And if you should break this oath?
I will not break it.
If you should break it, the earth will give you no bread but death. The sky no light but darkness.
I will not break it.
You must repeat the words, Aegis.
If I break it, the earth will give me no bread but death. The sky no light but darkness.
You have sworn. The gods have heard you.
But when will you come to Athens?
To Athens? Oh, to Athens. Why, if I come, if I live, it will be soon. The yokes on the necks of the horses.
I have some things to do that men will talk of afterwards with hushed voices, while I and my children safe in Athens laugh. Is that it? Farewell, Edith.
May the gods comfort you, my dear. And to you also, farewell, women of Corinth.
Fair be the gale behind you, sir, and the way ahead. What is she plotting in her deep mind? She is juggling with death and with life as a juggler with a black ball and a white ball.
No, she is like some distracted city sharpening its weapons. Embassies visit her. The heads of state come to her door. She receives them darkly.
I beseech you, women, not to speak words against my lady whom I love. You know what wicked injustice she has to suffer. Oh, God, protector of exiles, lord of the holy sky, lead us to the high rock that Athena loves and the olive garland of Athens.
Athens is beautiful as a lamp on a rock. The temples are marble shafted. Light shines and lingers there. Honey color among the carved stones and silver color on the leaves of the olives. The maidens are crowned with violets. Athens and Corinth are the two crowns of time.
Mycenae for spears and armor. Sparta for the stern men and the tall, blonde women. And Thebes, I remember. Old Thebes and the seven gates in the gray walls. But rather I praise Athena, the ivory, the golden, the gray-eyed virgin, her city. And also I praise Corinth of the beautiful fountains on the fair plain between the two gulfs.
God-favored cities of the Greek world. Fortunate those that dwell in them, happy that behold them.
How can one wish to die? How can that woman be drowned in sorrow and bewildered with hatred? For only to be alive and to see the light is beautiful. Only to see the light, or a blade of young grass, or the gray face of a stone.
As you say, what a marvelous privilege it is merely to be alive. And how foolish it would be to spend the one day of life that remains to me, at least in Corinth, this tag end of one day on tears and hatred. Rather, I should rejoice and sing and give gifts. And as to my enemies, I will be reconciled with them.
Reconciled with them?
As you say, reconciled. Why should they hate me? Surely I can appease those people. They say that gold will buy anything, even friendship, even love. At least in Greece, among you civilized people, you reasonable and civilized Hellenes, in fact, we've seen it happen. They bought Jason, Jason's love. Well, I shall buy theirs. I still have two or three of the treasures that I brought from home. Things of pure, precious gold, which a god gave to the kings, my ancestors. But is it late? It seems to me that the sky darkens. Is it evening?
No, no, a cloud.
I hope for thunder. Let the sky rage. My gifts will shine the brighter. Listen, old woman, I want you to go to Jason and tell him I am sick of hating and weary of evil. I wish for peace. I wish to send precious gifts to that pale girl with the yellow hair whom he has married. Tell him to come and take them and kiss his boys before we go into exile. Tell him to come speedily. Now run, run,
oh,
find
go
him.
Run. But I'm terrified. Pray to the gods to keep evil birth from our hearts.
Run, run, find him, find him. Ha, 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 ha I'm sending to the young bride this golden wreath and this woven gold veil. They're not without value. There's nothing like them in the whole world, or at least the Western world. The god of the sun gave them to my father's father, and I have kept them in the deep chest for some high occasion, which has now come. I have great joy in giving these jewels to Creon's daughter, for the glory of life consists of being generous to one's friends and merciless to one's enemies. You know what a friend she has been to me. All Corinth knows. The slaves talk of it. The old stones in the walls have watched and laughed. See, it is almost alive. Gold is a living thing, such pure gold. When her body has warmed it, how it will shine. Why doesn't he come? What keeps him?
Oh, my lady, presently. I've but now returned from him. He was outside the gates, watching the races, where a monstrous thing had happened. A young mare broke from the chariot and tore with her teeth a stallion.
He takes his time now. It is intolerable to sit and wait. Take these into the house. Keep them at hand for when I call. You say that a mare attacked a stallion?
She tore him cruelly. I saw him being led away, a black racer. His blood ran down from the throat to the pedestal.
You're sure he's coming? You're sure?
He said he would.
Let him make haste, then.
Frightening, irrational things have happened lately. The face of nature is flawed with omens. Yesterday evening, a slave came to the harbor gate carrying a basket of new-caught fish. One of the fish took fire and burned in the wet basket with a high flame. The thing was witnessed by many persons. And a black leopard was seen gliding through the marketplace.
You haven't told me yet. Do you not think Creon's daughter will be glad of those gifts?
Oh, Medea, too much wealth is sometimes dreadful.
She'll be glad, however. She'll take them and put them on. She'll wear them. She'll strut in them. She'll peacock in them. I see him coming now. The whole palace will admire her. Stand away from me, women, while I make my sick feast.
Well, I have come. I tell you plainly, not for your sake, the children's. Your woman says that you have your wits again and are willing to look beyond your own woes. It appears doubtful. Where are the children? I have made inquiry. I can find fosterage for them in Epidaurus or any other of several cities that are Creon's friends. I'll visit them from time to time and watch that they're well kept.
You men take them from me? Be careful, Jason. I'm not patient yet. I am the one who labored in pain to bear them. I cannot smile while I lose them. But I am learning. No, Jason, I will not give up my little ones to the cold care of strangers. Hard faces, harsh hands. It would be far better for them to share my wandering ocean of beggary and bleak exile. And when the storm rages, I'll hold them warm against my heart. I love them, Jason. Only if you would keep them and care for them here in Corinth, I might consent.
Gladly, but they are exiled.
In your own house.
Gladly, I tell you, but they are exiled as you are.
But innocent. For my rebellions. That's black. Oh, forgive me, Jason, as I do you. We've had too much wrath, and our acts are closing on us. On me, I mean. Retribution is from the gods, and it breaks our hearts. But you feel no guilt. You fear nothing. Nothing can touch you. It is wonderful to stand serene above fate while earthlings wince. If it lasts. It does not always last. You love the children, Jason.
Huh? Certainly. The children. Certainly, I'm their father.
Oh, but that's not enough. If I'm to give them up to you, be patient with me. I must question you first and deeply to the quick. If anything happened to them, would you be grieved?
Nothing will happen to them, Medea, if in my care. Rest your mind on it.
You must pardon me. It is not possible to be certain of that. If they were killed and their blood run on the floor of the house or down the deep earth, would you be grieved?
You've a sick mind. What a weak thing a woman is, always dreaming of evil.
Answer me!
Yes! After I'd cut their killer into red collops, I'd grieve.
Ah, that is true. Vengeance makes grief bearable. But Creon's daughter, your wife, no doubt will breed many other boys, but if something should happen to Creon's daughter...
Enough, Medea! Be silent!
I am to conclude that you love Creon's daughter more than your sons. They'll have to take the sad journey with me. Tell the boys to come out and bid their father farewell.
I could take them from you by force, Medea.
Try it. No, Creon decided otherwise. He said they will share my exile. Oh, come, Jason. Let's be friends at last. I know you love them. If they could stay here in Corinth, I'd be content.
I asked Creon, and he refused it.
You asked Creon to take my children from me? I am quite patient now. I have learned. Oh, come, boys, come. Speak to your father. No, we're friends again. We're not angry anymore.
Big boys, tall fellows. Why, you've grown up since I saw you.
Smile for him, children. Give him your hands.
I think he's afraid of your helmet, sir.
Why? You'll learn, my man, not to fear helmets. Why, the enemy will run from yours when you grow up to size. You, Captain, how would you like a horn-tipped bow to hunt rabbits with, huh? Wolves, I mean.
Don't give them to him, Medea. If you do, it will ache forever.
You have refuge. Take them there. Athens is beautiful.
Be silent. Look at him. He loves them, huh? Therefore, his dear children are not going to that city, but a darker city where no games are played, no music is heard. Do you think I'm a cow lowing after the calf or a bitch with pups licking the hand that struck her? Watch and see. Watch this man, women. He is going to weep. I think he is going to weep blood. Quite soon. Much more than I have wept. Watch and keep silence. Jason, are the boys very dear to you? I think I'm satisfied that you love them.
Why, these two young heroes... God's hand, Medea, what is it? What is the matter?
It's hard to let them go. This I have thought of. You will take them to Creon's daughter, your wife, and make them kneel to her, and ask her to ask her father to let them stay here in Corinth. He'll grant it. He's growing old. He denies her nothing. Even that hard king loves his only child. What she asked is granted. You will go with the boys, Jason, and speak for them. They're not skillful yet in supplication. And I'll send gifts. I'll put gifts in their hands. People say that gifts will persuade even the gods. Is it well thought of? Will she listen to us?
I ask it. She'd hardly refuse me anything. And I believe you're right. She can rule Creon.
Bring me those gold things. Dear ones, brave little falcons, little pawns of my agony, go ask that
proud, breathless girl of her bitter charity, whether she'll let you nest here until your wings fledge, while far your mother flies the dark storm.
I'm sorry for you. Parting is hard.
I can bear it. And worse, too. Oh, here. Here are the things. Take them, darlings, into your little hands. Hold carefully by the cases. Don't touch the gold, or it might tarnish.
These are king's treasures, Medea. You shouldn't. It's too much. Creon's house has gold enough of its own.
Oh, if she'll wear them. What should I want with woven gold and vanities black as my wear? A woman ought to be very happy with such jewels, huh? And such a husband. Her sun is rising, mine going down. I hope to a red sunset. The little gold wreath is pretty, isn't it?
Looks like fire.
Fine leaves. The flashing arrow-sharp leaves. They have weight, though. Gold is too heavy a burden for little hands. Carry them, you, until you come to the palace. Farewell, sweet boys. Brave little trudging pilgrims from the black wave to the white desert. Take the stuff in. Be sure you lay it in her own hands. Come back and tell me what happens. Tell me what happens. Rejoice, women. The gifts are given. The bait is laid. The gods roll their great eyes over Creon's house and quickly smile. Robe of bright flowing gold, that bride veil, that fish net to catch a young slender salmon. Not mute, she'll sing. Her delicate body writhes in the meshes. A golden wreath binds her bright head with light. She'll dance, she'll sing loudly. Would I were there to hear it. That proud one howling. Look, the sun's out again, the clouds are gone, all's gay and clear. I wish the deep earth would open and swallow me before I do what comes next. I wish all life would perish and the holy gods in high heaven die before my little ones come home to my hands.
It would be better for you, Medea, if the earth opened its jaws and took you down into darkness. But one thing you will not do, for you cannot. You will not hurt your own children. Though wrath like plague boils, ache your mind in a fire haze, bites the purple apples of pain. No blood-lapping beast of the field, she-bear, nor lioness, nor the lean wolf bitch has ever hurt her own tiny whelps. Nor the yellow-eyed, scythe-beaked, and storm-shouldered eagle that tears the lamb has ever made prey of the fruit of her own tree.
How could that girl's death slake me?
I'll run to the palace. I'll warn them. I'll warn them.
Will you go? Go if you will. God and my vengeful goddess are doing these things. You cannot prevent them. But you could easily fall in the same fire.
I'm afraid to go.
You are wise. Anyone running between me and my justice will reap what no man wants.
Not justice, vengeance. You have suffered evil. You wish to inflict evil.
I do, according to nature, what I have to do.
I have heard evil answer evil as thunder answers the lightning. Great waste voices in a hollow sky, and all that they say is death. I have heard vengeance answering vengeance like an echo under a hill. Great hollow voices, and all that they say is death.
The sword speaks and the spear answers. The city is desolate. The nations remember old wrongs and destroy each other. And no man binds up their wounds.
But justice builds a firm house. The doors of her house are vengeance.
I dreamed that someone gave good for evil and the world was amazed.
Only a coward or a madman gives good for evil. Shh. Did you hear a thin music? Like a girl screaming? Imagine it, huh? Ah! It is music!
you women. You came to see how the barbarian woman endures betrayal. Watch and you'll know.
My heart is a shaken cup of terror. The thin black wine spills over all my flesh down to my feet.
She fled from her father's house in a storm of blood. In a bloodstorm she flew up from Thessaly. Now here in dark over Corinth she widens wings to ride up the twisted whirlwind and talons to hold with. Oh, let me flee from this dark place and the pillared doorway.
I hear the man-wolf on the snow. He'll howl to the soaring moon.
The demon comes in through the locked door and strangles the child.
Blood is the seed of blood, hundredfold the harvest. The gleaners that follow it, their feet are crimson. I see the whirlpool hanging in the black sky like a twisted rope, like an erect serpent. Its tail tears the earth. Who will fly in it? These night shoring pillars and the dark door.
Have patience, women. Be quiet. I'm quite sure something has happened. Presently, someone will bring us news.
Look. The children are coming.
They have bright things in their hands. Their faces are clear and joyous. Was all this fear a dream? A dream!
Rejoice, Medea. I bring good news. The princess graciously received your presence and smiled. It is peace between you. She has welcomed the little boys. They are safe from exile. They'll be kept here. Their father is joyful.
Yes?
All Creon's house is well pleased. When we first went in, the serving women came and fondled the children. It was rumored through all the household that you and Jason were at peace again. Like word of a victory running through a wide city, when people gather in the streets to be glad together. And we brought the boys into the hall. We put those costly gifts into their hands. And then Jason led them before the princess. At first she looked angrily at them and turned away. But Jason said, "Don't be angry at your friends. You ought to love those whom I love. Look what they have brought you, dear." And she looked. Saw in the dark boxes the brilliant gold. She smiled then and marveled at it. And afterwards she caressed the children. She even said that this little one's hair was like fine spun gold. And then Jason gave them these toys and we came away.
Yes, if this were all, old man, I'd have your bony loins beaten to a blood froth for the good news you bring.
Oh, lady.
There's more, however, it will soon come.
Look, Mother, look where I am!
Oh, no, take them away from me. I cannot bear.
But if any mercy or forbearance in heaven, let it reach down and touch that dark mind to save it from what it dreams.
I am Jason's man, but you were good to me while I was here in the house. Can you hear me? Escape, Medea!
I hear you. Draw breath. Say quietly what you have seen. It must have been something notable, the way your eyes bulge in the white.
If you have horses, drive, Medea, or a boat upon the shore, sail!
But first you must tell me about that beautiful young girl who was lately married. Your great man's daughter. Are they all quite well?
My ears ring with the crying. My eyes are scalded. She put on the gold garment. She... Did you do it, Medea?
I did it. Speak quietly.
You are avenged. You are horribly avenged. It is too terrible. The gods will hate you.
That is my care. Did anyone die with her?
Creon.
Where is pride now? Tell me all that you saw. Speak slowly.
He tried to save her. He died. Corinth is masterless. All's in amazed confusion and some are looting. But they'll avenge him. I'm going on. Someone's going to die.
Here comes a more stable witness. Old friend, catch your breath, take your time. I want the whole story, every gesture and cry. I have labored for this.
Death is turned loose. I've hobbled and run and fallen.
Please, nurse, I'm very happy. Speak slowly. Tell me these things in order from the beginning. When you used to dress me when I was little in my father's house, you used to say one thing at a time, one thing and then the next.
My eyes are blistered, my throat's like a dry straw. There was a long mirror on the wall, and when her eyes saw it after the children had gone with Jason, she put her hands in the gold case and took out those gold things. And I watched, for I feared something might happen to her, but I never thought so horribly. She placed on her little head the bright golden wreath. She gathered the flowing gold robe round her white shoulders and her slender flanks. And she gazed at the golden girl in the metal mirror, going back and forth on tiptoe almost, and swung her leg from the hip to see the flexible gold molding the thigh. But suddenly, horror began.
You are not suffering. You saw it. You did not feel it. Speak plainly.
Her face went white. She staggered a few steps, bending over, and fell into the great throne chair. Then a serving woman began to call for water, thinking she'd fainted, but saw the foam start on her lips and her eyes rolling and screamed instead. Then some of them ran after Cleon. Others ran to fetch Jason. And that doomed girl, frightfully crying, started up from the chair. She ran. She was like a torch. And the gold crown, like a comet, streamed fire. She tore at it, but it clung to her head. The golden cloak was white hot, flaying the living flesh from the bones. Blood mixed with fire ran down. She fell. She burned on the floor, writhing. Then Creon came and flung himself on her, hoping to choke that rage of flame, but it ran through him. His own agony made him forget his daughter. The fire stuck to the flesh. It glued him to it. He tried to stand up. He tore her body in his own. The burnt flesh broke in lumps from the bones.
I have no more.
I want all. Had they died when you came away?
Hello. The breath still whistled in the black mouth. No one could touch them.
They lie there, mittens of broken flesh. Eyeless despair. Untouchable.
You have told good news well. I'll reward you. As for those people, they will soon die. Their woes are over too soon. Mine are not. Jason's are not. My little falcons, listen to me, laugh and be glad we have accomplished it. Our enemies were great and powerful. They were full of cold pride. They ruled all this country. They're down in the ashes, crying like dogs, cowering in the ashes, in their own ashes. They went down with the sun, and the sun will rise again and not see them. He will think, perhaps they feasted late. At noon, they will walk in the garden. Oh, no, they will not walk in the garden. No one has ever injured me, but suffered more than I have suffered. Therefore, this final sacrifice I intended glares in my eyes like a lion on a ridge. We still hate, you know, a person nearer than these. More vile, more contemptible, whom I
cannot. If he were my own hands, I would cut him off, or my eyes, I would gouge him out, but not you. That was madness.
So Jason will be able to say I've lost much, but not all. I have children. My sons are well.
I want him crushed
boneless, crawling. I have no choice.
You there. You thought me soft and submissive like a common woman who takes a blow. She wipes her face and runs about the housework loving her master. I am not such a woman.
Awake, Medea. Awake from the evil dream. Catch up your children and flee. Farther than Athens, farther than Thrace or Spain, flee to the world's end. Fire and death have done your bidding. Are you not fed full of evil? Is it not enough?
No! Loathing is endless. Hate. Tis a bottomless cup. I will pour and pour. Children!
My little one. What was I dreaming? My babes. My own. Never, 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 never shall my own babes be hurt. Not if every war hound and spear slave and headless Corinth were on the track. Look, their sweet lips are trembling. Look, women, the little mouths. I frightened them with those wild words. They stood and faced me. They never flinched. Look at their proud young eyes. My eaglets. My golden ones. Sweet small faces. Like the pale wild roses that bloom where the cliff breaks toward the brilliant sea. A delicate form and color. The dear, dear fragrance of your sweet breath.
My dear, make haste. Haste! Take them and flee. Flee away from here. Someone will come soon. Listen to me. Spears will come. Death will come. All Corinth is in confusion and a kingless anarchy. Amazed around that horror that you made. Therefore they linger yet in a moment. It's avengers come.
I have a sword in the house. I can defend you.
And you say this child had Jason's eyes. They are his cubs. They have his blood. As long as they live, I will be mixed with him. Children, it is evening. See? Evening has come. Come, little ones, into the house. Evening brings all things home. Brings the bird to the bough, and the lamb to the fold, and the child to the mother. You must not think too much. People go mad if they think too much.
Now! What is going to happen?
The crown of horrors!
In heaven or earth. It is done. It was destined when she was born. Now it is done.
Who's coming? Someone is running at us.
The accursed man, Jason.
He has the sword.
I am more afraid of the clinging contagion of his misfortunes. A man that the gods are destroying.
Where is that murderess? Is she in the house? Or has she fled? She left to hide in the heavy metal darkness and caves of the earth. And there I'll crawl and find her. Are you struck dumb? Are you shielding her? Where is Medea?
Caused these things. She was faithful to you and you broke faith. Horror is here.
Tell me at least whether she took my boys with her. Creon's people would kill them for what she has done. I'd rather save them than punish her. Help me in this. So she's killed herself. She never lacked courage. boys away to the far ends of the earth and never speak of these things again. Is she lying in there? Honorable, at least in her death, I might have known it. Answer!
Is there? Death is here, but you are both blind and deaf. How can I tell you?
Children are well.
I do not know whether Medea lives or is dead.
Open! Open! Women, women, help me. Help me to break the bolt. Go and find help!
What feeble night bird overcome by misfortunes beats at my door? Can this be that great adventurer, the famous lord of the seas and delight of women, the heir of rich Corinth, this crying drunkard on the dark doorstep? Yet you've not had enough. You've come to drink the last bitter drop. I'll pour them for you.
What's that stain on your hand?
The wine I was pouring for you spilled on my hand. Dear were the little grapes that were crushed to make it. Dear were the vineyards.
I came to kill you, Medea, like a caught beast, like a crawling viper. Only give me my sons, that I may save them from Creon's men. I'll go quietly away.
Shh, they are sleeping. Perhaps I will let you look at them. You cannot have them. But the hour is late. You ought to go home to that high-born bride. The night has fallen. Surely she longs for you. Surely her flesh is not crusted black, nor her forehead burned bald, nor her mouth a horror. She's very young, but surely she loves and desires you. Surely she will be fruitful. Your sword you want, there it is. Not that step, the next there.
I'll kill you first, and then find my sons.
Must be careful, Jason. Do you not see these two fire snakes that guard my door? Here and here, one on each side, two serpents. Their throats are swollen with poison, their eyes are burning coals, their tongues are fire, they are coiled ready to strike. If you come near them, they'll make you what Creon is. Stand there very quietly. I'll let you look at your sons. Open the doors, that he may see them.
I knew it already. I knew it before I saw it. No wild beast could have done it.
I have done it because I loathed you more than I loved them.
Did you feel nothing, no pity? Are you pure evil? I should have killed you the day I saw you.
I tore my own heart and I was tearing yours.
And you laugh while I strangle you.
I was doorholders, Jason, these eager serpents. I'd still be joyful to know that every bone of your life is broken. But you are left hopeless. Friendless, mateless, childless, avoided by gods and men, unclean with awful excess of grief. Childless.
No matter now, who lives or who dies.
You had love and betrayed it.
Now, of all men, you are utterly the most miserable. As I, of women. But I, a woman, a foreigner, alone against you and the might of Corinth, have met you throat for throat. Evil for evil, vengeance for vengeance.
Oh, give me my boys, the little pitiful violated bodies, that I may bury them in some kind place.
To you! You would betray even the little bodies, coin them for silver, sell them for power. No.
Let me touch their dear flesh, let me touch their hair.
No, they're mine. They're going with me. The chariot is in the gate. Go down to your ship Argo and weep beside it. That rotting hulk on the harbor beach, drawn dry as strand, never to be launched again. Even the weeds and barnacles on the warped keel are dead and stink. That's your last companion and only hope. For sometime, one of the rotting timbers will fall on your head and kill you. Meanwhile, sit there and mourn, remembering the infinite evil and the good that you made. Now I go forth to wander under the cold, clear eyes of heaven, those weakness-despising stars. Not me they scorn.